Hollywood's next big bomb will be set off by this terrorist.
All right, drop your guns and kick him over here.
And if anyone can stop him, so can Frank Drebin.
Detective Lieutenant Police Squad.
Yeah, and I'm Robert De Niro.
Mr. De Niro, we've got to get inside.
Ladies and gentlemen, it's my pleasure to proceed.
Naked Gun 33 and a third, the final insult. Rated PG-13. Starts Friday, March 18th at theaters everywhere.
Welcome to From the Files of Police Squad in color. I'm your host, Mike White. Joining me is Mr. Chris Dashew.
I prefer to go by my prison name, Randy McGurk.
And of course, back with us again is Mr. Mark Begley.
Well, it's not exactly the backyard, but it'll do.
On this episode, we are wrapping things up with Naked Gun 33 and a third, The Final Insult. And yeah, one of my younger coworkers was saying, why is it called 33 and a third? That doesn't make any sense. That joke did not last, gentlemen. It is outdated.
It was outdated when they made the joke.
It would have made a little more sense if they had kept their original subtitle for it, which was Just for the Record. Naked Gun 33 and a third, Just for the Record.
Which is a funny ass title. Like, that's
it makes
fucking
sense.
Hilarious. Oh, yeah.
And then they decided, well, that's no one's going to get that. And I'm like, well, if no one's going to get that, who the fuck is going to get 33 and a third?
Right.
Change that too, then.
But if they watch the movie, they'll understand the final insult part, as the film is an insult to your intelligence.
Change the numeric aspect of it to 3-something or 3¾. I'll keep that going, or make it a decimal this time instead of 2.5. Why 33 and a third if you're not going to keep Just for the Record?
And also, nobody calls it that. Can we just point this out? Like, when we've been referring to this movie at any point during this show or in our private conversations about Police Squad, you'd be surprised how many of those there are. And also, in any of the conversations any of us have probably had with people letting them know we're doing this show, I would be surprised if any of us referred to this as Naked Gun 33 and a third. We probably called it Naked Gun 3. It's not like Hot Shots Part 2, where they've done something funny with the number and you can't avoid it. Like you just said, like, this is completely avoidable. And it's just called Naked Gun 3. Like, I'm sorry. That's what this is.
Yeah, I don't get why they were so beholden with the 33 and a third.
Because it was 2.5.
Yeah, so call it the
which
3 and a third.
Funny. Right, which was funny. Like, 2.5 is funny. The movie's opening gag doesn't even make sense. The poster gag doesn't make sense.
This is the first of these to not be directed by a Zucker and Abrahams or a Zucker. It is directed by Peter Siegel, not to be confused with Peter Sagal, the guy who hosts Wait, Wait, Don't Tell Me on NPR. This is a totally different guy. This is a guy who fell into some really bad movies.
That's an understatement.
Oh, boy. I mean, he's got some good stuff in there, too. I really like the remake of The Longest Yard. I kind of like 51st Dates, but not really. The rest of these aren't so good, man.
How much can you hate a movie that has Sean Astin in it?
Well, not at all.
I don't know. That Body Swap movie with Sean Astin isn't very good.
Oh, I've never actually seen Tommy Boy, guys.
What?
That's, yeah.
I've
never seen that.
He hooked his wagon to the, what is that production
the
company?
The Sandler train. Yeah. Happy Madison. Yeah.
Happy Madison train. I think Gary Sanchez too is kind of a offshoot of that. Gary Sanchez Productions.
Tommy Boy is pretty great.
I mean, look, Tommy Boy could have been directed by a nutless chimp, frankly. Like,
right.
It has a seminal pairing of David Spade and Chris Farley, who would have been Abbott and Costello for their day and age if Chris Farley had not succumbed to his personal demons. There's none of that here. There's none of that here, folks. It's you're right. This guy directs comedies, and almost exclusively comedies.
Oh, yeah. I also haven't seen My Spy, that one with Dave Bautista, which unfortunately fell victim of the pandemic in a hard way.
Oh, my God.
I remember the poster and trailer for that years before it was finally available.
Is that with him and a little kid?
Yeah.
Is that one?
Yeah, it's yeah. One of those.
It is the wrestler has to go and be a father to a child movie, just like The Rock did with that football movie. You guys remember that? The Game Plan.
Oh, I thought you were talking about Tooth Fairy. Or there was also Mr. Nanny with Hulk Horatio Hogan.
Also, there was what's the one with Triple H? The Chaperone, where he's like a chaperone at a school with Michael Rapaport.
Wow. Stunning.
Did Barton Fink write it?
Does it have that Barton Fink feeling?
Could be a pip.
Wally Beery is a wrestler. I want to know his hopes, his dreams. Naturally, you have to get mixed up with a bad element. And romantic interest. You know the drill. Romantic interest, or else a young kid, an orphan. What do you think, Lou? Wally a little too old for romantic interest? Look at me. A writer in the room, and I'm asking Lou what the goddamn story should be. Which is it, Bart? Orphan? Dame? Both, maybe?
So he's also working on a sequel to My Spy and a new version of Harvey. I think this might be the third filmed version of Harvey. So we'll see how that goes. I don't know if mental illness will play as funny in 2023, 2024 as it did back when old Jimmy Stewart was kind of a nut.
I wouldn't want to tackle that project in 2023.
Yeah.
Me personally.
Hey, you know what they have in Naked Gun 33 and a third? The cigarette gag.
Yeah.
It's back, baby.
The poster's correct. Mostly new jokes.
Thank God it showed up for the third movie, huh?
Yeah.
It is, actually. I don't think there's a lot of callbacks to the show other than that. It's the most different from the show of these three films.
I think it's the most different from all of the other things, even, really. Like, even from the other movies, right? Like, weird. When we were watching it, because you and I, Mark, have watched these now together, when we were watching it, the thing that you pointed out was beyond astute, and it's what these things have devolved into, which is specific parodies of specific things in specific movies. This movie, and then Wrongfully Accused and everything after this, just like leans on it so hard. As much as I like Mafia, I know that Mafia is specifically parodying specific scenes from specific movies. It just happens to work there because they're doing all Mafia movies, and that's the genre of movie that they're doing, so you've got a lot of room to play in. This could be playing in the crime police world, and it just decides not to. It starts parodying random things completely, and to the point where, again, I wonder, why are we making a third one or a 33rd one?
I don't know.
I think I like this one better than you guys, but I don't like it a ton. I like some of the scenes that they have in here. I like the whole thing with the Untouchables at the beginning, even though it's kind of a cheat that it's a dream sequence.
Total cheat.
Yeah, there's...
Kind of makes more sense, though, that it is.
Right. That's the only way it makes sense.
Why are they doing this?
Right.
Plus, that movie at that point was 7 years old, for Pete's sake.
The scene of them in the 70s bar doesn't work at all for me, because they're using that as kind of a send-up of the disco era. We've already seen that in Airplane. The whole thing with Norberg and the huge fro, it's kind of funny, but not that funny. They're really using it for introducing Anna Nicole Smith's character in that she knows Frank, and there's no reason why she should know Frank. It's just, it's really kind of sloppy writing in that regard, and they're really taking a lot of time to telegraph all of these things and give us all the machinations of Rocco, the Fred Ward character, and him being hired by Papschmier, and the whole relationship with his mother, and then just, it was just like, okay, wow, this is like the most plot heavy of the Naked Guns of any of these ZAZ-ish films that I think I've ever seen.
Not to split hairs and be that guy again, but her looking exactly the same in the 70s as she does in 1994 is a bit of a stretch.
Not even a different haircut.
Yeah.
Well, they should have given her like a comical hairstyle or something they did with everybody else. They gave Leslie Nielsen, you know, a crazy haircut, and O.J. Simpson's entire point of being in that scene is to have the afro, which if you watch the trailer for this movie, they completely spoil that gag, which is such a waste, because spoiling it in the trailer is a waste because it's not really funny. But to show it for free is even less funny, because when you see it in the movie, you're like, OK, all right, I saw. Well, remember that from the trailer? What I don't understand about this movie is it feels a lot like a mashup of the first movie and the second movie together. The third act is completely isolated to this one essentially room, which mirrors the second movie too, but the first movie a lot. And then it has a thing that the first movie doesn't have, but the second movie does, which is like several villains that Frank has to contend with, which kind of adds to, I think, the plot contrivances that we run into. Because when it was just, or Vincent Ludberg, or whatever the fuck Ricardo Montalban's character's name is, the character he plays, Vincent Ludwig, it's just him and Frank. That's it. There's not, I mean, there's the goons, but not anybody else. And the second movie has to contend with all those kind of other people, you know, the Meinheimer, and then, and whatever the hell Robert Goulet's character is. I just think this movie has way too many people, way too much going on, and Anna Nicole Smith completely in the movie for one singular gag at the end of the movie. That is not funny. It's not funny. I don't even know what it is, but it's not funny. It's shocking.
The crying game gag?
Yeah.
Yeah. But, like, might be offensive. The word might be offensive.
I would say it's offensive. I'm not trans, so I don't want to speak for the trans community. I would be offended if they made a gag like that about Frank being gay, but they already did, and it actually kind of worked with the throwing around of the pigskin. That entire scene is pretty funny. I find it to be probably the best part of the entire movie.
There's a lot of gay panic in this movie.
Yeah, and a lot of race, and a lot of just like casual racism too.
Yeah.
Surprising it's not directed by the Zuckers, though. What's up with that?
I mean, and then also just very anti-feminist too, with the whole court scene.
Yeah.
Right.
Weird. Was that even funny?
No. And it didn't make sense either that it was a woman who was the defense attorney, because it's like all of these women all have their hyphenated names and they all have babies and all this kind of stuff. And I know it's supposed to trigger like Jane not having a baby and her being, you know, really weird about that. Why have the prosecuting or defense attorney breastfeeding, and she's got even more hyphenated names and stuff. And those hyphenated names, it could have been a lot funnier too. Like, you could have really mixed, like, you know, an Irish name, an Italian name, an African, like some sort of like really odd combination of names, but they weren't even that funny.
Also, the optics are weird of the main characters in this movie wanting to have a baby when they're both old enough to be the baby's grandparent.
Oh, Jesus Christ. Yeah.
It is kind of fucking weird, because Leslie Nielsen at this point is how old? I know Priscilla Presley is 49 at the time. I mean, again, not commenting on her looks or anything else, just the optics of what this movie is going for are so antithetical to what is even funny in this series. And not to mention, and they've done it now twice. In the first movie, it worked. The second movie, it kind of worked. Third movie, I don't think it did. Why do they keep separating them and having them have to come back together, and they're breaking up and coming back to the fucking drop it movie? At the end of the second movie, there shouldn't have been any more of this bullshit. There shouldn't have been any more of them going around in a circle chasing each other. Even if it is like, oh, I didn't understand that it was he was on the case and he went to the sperm clinic. Like, all you got to do is just tell that. Like, it's just contrived writing, because they don't have any idea of what they're trying to do here anymore. It's just like, let's make funny fart pee-pee jokes and like weird gay baiting jokes and trans hating jokes. Like, it's kind of a mean movie, more so than the first two were. To what end?
There's just some odd things in here. And like, I don't think they take some jokes far enough. I think it would have been funny. Like, the whole relationship between Rocco and his mother to me is very white heat. And just go for it when it comes to like incestuous stuff, and make it like a total incest relationship between Rocco and his mom. Like, why not go that far? If you're going to go for comedy and taboo, break that taboo, you know, make him more attracted to her than to Tanya.
Speaking of Tanya, my daughter was in the room and I was watching it today, but not really paying attention. She did happen to catch the extended leg scene, and which I think is one of the better gags in the film. And she enjoyed it quite a bit. She's like, what's going on? That doesn't look right. Why does she have Barbie legs? And then, oh no, two knees. How does that even work? I don't know.
The knees that really do it for me. It's that second set of knees that just really, I mean, that's the thing. This movie, I think more or less has completely rejected the smart dialogue driven comedy of the previous two movies. And this is leaning hard on kind of what we were talking about at the beginning, which is this like sight gag driven pop culture-y specific thing that it's like really going for. I don't know why. I mean, I do know, I feel like we could agree why, that it's way harder to do one over the other, but what Police Squad was known for was that smart, well-written dialogue and those funny wordplay jokes. And there's like none of it in this movie.
Mm-hmm.
Not zero, but pretty close.
I was just starting to edit the sixth episode of Police Squad today. And we were already bemoaning how different that was from, you know, especially those first three episodes of the show. I had just watched this again, and I'm like, this is so much, even from that sixth episode, this is so much further away that you don't get any of that name play. You don't get anything like a green screen scene of Rome behind, nothing like that even. It's just, there's too much plot having the story take over everything. And I think that's why they've got, again, them being separated, which is annoying. Like you said, Chris, that whole thing, it feels like it's just to get her to that hideout. It's like, you couldn't have done it another way.
They had to parody Thelma and Louise.
Yeah.
Fucking sustained Thelma and Louise parody. That's feels like 10 minutes.
Doesn't pay off though.
Well, no. The payoff is funny guy gets hit by a car and then is perfectly fine. That's hilarious. I was laughing just in tears.
But there's one more beat to that joke that they cut out, which was Ellen Green, who I didn't realize was playing the other character, the Thelma to her Louise, or Louise to her Thelma, that she then starts making out with the guy with the offensive hat, the guy that got hit by the truck. And that's where that joke, that was the button for that joke. I don't think it was a good button. And how disappointed was I that we finally get to go to Statesville prison and we don't get any reference to any of the criminals that Frank sent away all those years ago.
It's a massive missed opportunity, right?
Yeah.
Mark, you mentioned it, the Statesville prison thing, when we were watching it. If you're going to do that, which they did it in the show over and over and over and over again, and David Zucker's name is still on this, even if he didn't direct it, they could have at least had him walking down those cells with, there was a shot of people already in their cells. You could have just had the names above, Sally Decker, blah, 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 blah. You know what? This movie's not great, but I would have appreciated that note of continuity because, again, we're led to believe this is all within the same continuity anyways. No, we're not.
Well, now we are squarely in Los Angeles.
Right.
There's no more pretending that we're anyplace else because there's no mention of the Academy Awards at all throughout this entire movie. Then suddenly, boom, we end up at the Academy Awards. Right? Total freak out.
Aside from the fact that they keep mentioning how bad L.A. is because, oh, don't you forget, we're right in prime L.A. riot time.
Yeah,
so that's fun and really a ugh.
That they parody the Rodney King line.
Yeah.
You know, that hurts when you do that in a movie. The guy's trying to quell the rioting, gives a sincere plea about people getting along, and then they turn it into a joke. And I'm like, wow, that's really bad.
From the creators of An American Carol.
Yeah.
The problem here with some of this is it hadn't aged well. It's problematic, but it wasn't great at the time. Again, at the time, I don't know if it's offensive. It's just more, frankly, even though I wasn't able to watch this in 1994, this is low-hanging fruit then. wow, and LA is a terrible place joke. Wow, like, you're so creative. Except not. Like,
this isn't me being some sort of woke hipster type guy, just like, oh my God, I'm so offended by this stuff. It's just that it was such easy comedy. You know,
yeah.
You go,
yeah.
All right, you got your Untouchables, you got your Thelma and Louise, you got your White Heat or any other of these prison movies. I was even thinking of Shawshank, which I think came out about the same year. But when they're digging the tunnel, I was just like, oh, there's going to be a poster hanging over it and the poster's going to be hilarious. No, that came a little bit later. But it was just like, okay, you got all of these beats, and then we end up in, I would say, a fairly solid, if overlong, end sequence all taking place at the Academy Awards, which feels like that is cut from a different cloth than the rest of this film.
Well, all of a sudden, they're really forced to focus the comedy, and there's a ticking bomb, obviously, but that level of stakes actually lights a fire under the ass of the writers to give us some interesting jokes and some interesting gags. I mean, there are some shitty ones thrown in there, like all of the really weird fake movies. Like, the fake movies they come up with aren't very funny. I mean, Mother Teresa dancing around hitting small children. I mean, I guess it's funny, but to what end?
I mean, they had Weird Al right there. They should have had him pitching some ideas about this stuff. I mean, Conan the Librarian,
right.
Gandhi 2, they are so much funnier than this one. Like, the four with the women and the whole, like, struggle against blah set against the whatevers of whatever, like, that kind of works. And that actually, like, when they cut away and they're supposed to be doing, like, physical comedy, I'm listening to those movie descriptions. I'm like, these are funnier than what's actually going on screen. And just the caliber of actresses that they have for that stuff. But then you throw in Olympia Dukakis and James Earl Jones, and I'm like, why are these two here? Like, we have all of these, like, Z-level celebrities. I mean, and Muriel Hemingway and Elliot Gould, they don't fit in either.
Elliot Gould is there, baby.
Florence Henderson,
what's he doing there?
And Mary Lou Retton and all of these, like, strange celebs that you would see show up on, like, I don't know, Hollywood Squares or something. And then you throw in these folks. I mean, I thought Raquel Welch was hilarious, but she doesn't really fit with the rest of the caliber, but she at least interacts with Frank in that scene. But like, Pia Zadora is like the queen of cheese, and to have a music number by her, I was like, well, that's appropriate. That fits with the movie, but some of these other people just don't whatsoever.
I thought you were going to get a big kick out of seeing Elliot Gould in this movie randomly for literally no reason.
A Gould sighting is always an appreciated thing.
Honestly, that's the other thing. This movie, again, kind of leans on the same thing that some of these later epic movie disaster movies do, where it's random celebrity cameos just because. They have nothing. It's not like Charlie Sheen being cast in Scary Movie 3, where he's playing a main character in that movie. I mean, he was still an actor at the time. He's not like the personality I guess he is now. But most of the people in this movie that are the cameos, completely random. Like you just said, Elliot Gould. Florence Henderson makes sense only because she's already been on this franchise.
And there's also some sort of theme of the Brady Bunch going through here, because mm-hmm. they've got Ann B. Davis showing up as well.
Randomly. So like,
well, why not have Mike Lookinland be the director instead of bringing back the guy from The Wharf in the first movie? I mean, he's a great guy.
That's right.
He's a great character actor. I love him when he shows up. And I was really glad to see Earl Bowen, RIP, playing another psychiatrist in this movie.
Yeah. Joe Grafasi's role in this movie is so much better than in the first one.
It is.
He's so good. He plays that role perfectly. The harried manager of the control room. He's so good. It's great. He's fan. It's sad because the third act of this movie is actually pretty fun. The fact that it gets so low to where we need to get rather high. I mean, I think the third act of this movie is pretty close to the third act of the first movie in a lot of ways.
Very close.
Like, in terms of quality.
Even setting and everything right. else. You're
what's more iconic than the Academy Awards?
I love Elliot Gould too, but his, they're not really jokes, but nothing really lands when the presenters are presenting.
No, it's so dry, and it's not that dry humor. You know, none of, to your point from earlier, Chris, none of that verbal humor is here. None of that but that's not important right now. Like, none of that deadpan Joe Friday delivery that we're getting in the TV series, that's a thing of the past. We are so far away from that now. And I just miss it so much.
There was one line he says when he's talking to Ted again. There were a couple of that he's oblivious to what's going on, and I can't remember what any of them are, but that was it. If there were any at all, that was it. Maybe one or two when he's back at the police station, which, even though he goes to police squad a couple of times, George Kennedy and OJ are pretty much out of the picture in this one. It's Priscilla Presley doing the legwork as opposed to them.
Right. They're just like, where's Frank?
And they just show up at the Oscars because they see him on TV.
Exactly.
And, oh, that's where the bomb must be.
And then they do that gag from the second movie again, where the doors get blocked on the vehicles and they can't get out. And it was just as, it's not that it's unfunny. It's just not a thing to laugh at. Like, two dudes trying to get out of a car. Like, why are you wasting time on this movie? Because you've already done it once. Why are we chasing? I just don't understand why they chase their tails on some of these jokes. I guess at some point, was it just weird? Expecting that the audience's expectation are we're going to hit some of the same notes. So here's some of those same notes. I guess that's what it's got to be. But at the same time, they completely ignore any dialogue comedy in this movie. So I don't know what they thought the audience wanted, frankly. People still showed up for this movie. This movie was still immensely successful. It just wasn't critically successful. It wasn't. But financially, this movie still made money. So maybe people just wanted more dumb, less highbrow. It's not even highbrow. It's just smart comedy, interesting comedy, unique comedy, not just the same gags over and over again. You hang a lantern on it, mostly new jokes. Wow.
To give credit where credit is due, and apparently this was a joke they thought of on set the day of, was Fred Ward coming down off of his apple box and actually showing him jumping down off of his apple box when he was standing next to, I keep wanting to say, Nicole Brown Simpson, Anna Nicole Smith.
Are you upset that the killer of Ron and Nicole was never found?
Right now, I'm not going to discuss any of that. All right? Yeah, I think that's a pretty obvious question. But I'm not getting in that. I'm not going there.
That was hilarious to me.
Well, it's like the gag in the second movie with the heels, right? Where Priscilla Presley's wearing those crazy tall heels.
Yeah.
That gag's hilarious. Again, Fred Ward is pretty good in this. He is a good actor to cast opposite Leslie Nielsen. Honestly, it feels like they didn't get enough screen time for me. I would have preferred to see them just go back and forth, because Fred Ward calling Leslie Nielsen McGurk never gets old.
Oh, yeah.
Listen here, McGurk, because Fred Ward can't talk out of the front of his mouth. He only talks out of the side of his mouth at all times.
You've got so many prison tropes that you could be playing with when they're in prison. And it really doesn't make any sense to me when Arlie Ermey comes up and finds their plan and they have the whole prison riot. I'm like, do they just straight up murder Arlie Ermey? Is that how he doesn't report that they have a plan?
He's gone. That's his... however long that scene is with him, he disappears after that.
He must have been on the Paramount backlot, and they were just like, hey, Arlie, what the fuck is the point of having him in anything in the 90s if he's not just playing this role? Holy shit. Talk about someone who made a killing for a decade and a half on just one role, one singular thing, yelling at people and calling them, I guess, probably in Full Metal Jacket, terrible things. And this, he just kind of...
butter cheeks.
Yeah, it's not anything remotely offensive here.
Bullshit, from now on, you're Private Snowball. Do you like that name?
Yes, sir!
Well, there's one thing that you won't like, Private Snowball. They don't serve fried chicken and watermelon on a daily basis in my mess hall.
Yes, sir!
Where in hell are you from anyway, Private?
Sir, Texas, sir!
Holy dog shit, Texas, only steers and queers come from Texas, Private Cowboy. And you don't much look like a steer to me, so that kind of narrows it down. Do you suck dicks?
Sir, no, sir!
Bullshit, I'll bet you could suck a golf ball through a garden hose.
Sir, no, sir!
I don't like the name Lawrence, only faggots and sailors are called Lawrence. From now on, you're Gomer Pyle.
He occasionally would show up and do drama, very rarely. And when he did, it was oh, wow. he's really good. Like, mm-hmm. I really would have liked to have seen more of him. And the one guy who I really like, he doesn't even get credit in the credits. Bruce A. Young as Tyrone, who I really love when he shows up, and I love all the stuff that he's doing. And then he just goes to solitary confinement, and we never see him again.
I was trying to find him on IMDb. I'm like, who's playing the other guy? Because I know I've seen him and stuff, and I looked, kept looking through the list to see his face or the name, and I couldn't find it. What is that all about?
Well, they were saying in the commentary that they really had to convince him to be in the movie, that he didn't want to do it. I don't know why, but apparently he probably said, yeah, don't give me credit. He's not credited. Raquel Welch isn't credited. I mean, there's a lot of people. James Earl Jones, Mariel Hemingway. There's a lot of people that don't have credits in this. I mean, Arlie Ermey doesn't even have credit.
I can kind of understand the cameos, but I'm like, wait, I know this guy from all kinds of stuff. Hey, he's in Jurassic Park.
Yeah.
I thought I was losing my mind for a minute there because I could not find his face or the character name on the credits list.
But you know who is billed in this film? Future all-star director Paul Feig in the audience, front and motherfucking center. Yeah. Doing his hilarious. He's such a good director. His reactions are great. He has like one, which is just putting his hand over his mouth and pointing, which is what he does like four times.
Oh, man. Yeah, I was pretty disappointed to see him.
Why does he get a credit?
Friend of the director?
Michigan's own Paul Feig, mind you.
Oh, I don't want anything to do with that.
We don't hold that against the state of Michigan.
One of the other things that we noticed when we were watching it, Chris, was when Ed and Nordberg, go to Frank's house, and that weird scene where they're eating the cupcakes and OJ is looking off. Oh, yeah. Try to pay a little closer attention to it today while I was watching it. And I think he was getting direction and they just didn't cut the scene at the right time. Cause he goes up with the cupcake and then looks, takes it back down, goes back up, never takes a bite. He's not looking at Frank. Frank is up and a little to his left, but his eye line is down and to the right. I'm like, what is going on?
Wow. Yeah. It's real bad.
His line readings through the rest of the film are atrocious anyway, but that whole thing, I was just like, is he even in the same scene right now in his head? Bizarre.
Well, you know, we've kind of mentioned it a couple times now, but I think it's fair to say OJ Simpson, not a good actor.
No.
No.
And it's just even funnier that this is right before all hell breaks loose.
Oh, yeah.
His life. This comes out like 3 months before the shit goes down.
Oh, just, yeah.
He was probably still cashing those checks, man.
He may have
bought the gloves and the knife with money he made from Naked Gun 33 and a third. Just think about that.
Oh, my God.
The commentary was pretty funny when they're talking about directing Anna Nicole Smith. And that he's like, you see that? See that? That was her going, C-stand, sandbag. C-stand. Like, that's what he had to tell her. It was like, you look here, and then you look here, and that's it. Because she is the worst actress, and they managed to get a somewhat decent performance out of her.
I mean, she just has to stand around?
Yeah.
I will give her credit for being better than OJ in this.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Point out the lowest of low bars to cross, but right. I don't know. You could have made it a lower bar for her to cross, but I'm not sure how.
I don't recall having seen any of her other performances, so I can't gauge it against those.
Not even that video I sent you where it's all the outtakes from that.
No, oh, no.
Die Hard ripoff. Oh, boy. That's amazing.
Skyscraper.
Yeah. Oh, my God.
She was in the Hudsucker Proxy.
Oh, yeah. I do remember that.
She was in a couple movies, but this is it for her, really. Like, this is the big role, is this movie.
If anybody could churn a performance out of somebody, I think it's the Coen brothers.
Well, speaking of Coen brothers, you get Randall Tex Cobb in here, totally wasted.
Oh, my God.
Wasted again. Yeah, I've just put underused for all these people.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, and he's one of the great character actors of all time.
And then he disappears.
Total piece of shit from the sound of it, like real life. But he looks so menacing. Like, you could have made the case it should have been him getting out of prison with Fred Ward. I always kind of remember the movie that he does, but I always convince myself he's in this movie more than he is. I really always think he's like, oh, he's in the end of the movie. Nope.
Yeah, he should have escaped, maybe not with them, but after them
as well.
And shown up as another danger or another threat at the Oscars.
I mean, as much as I like Catherine Freeman as an actress, she's not intimidating.
No.
She's not an intimidating force that I really am worried that Leslie Nielsen won't be able to handle. Like, she's a 5-foot-tall woman who's in her 60s.
Yeah, I like her a lot as well, but I feel like she's pretty wasted in this.
It's a shame because she's really funny. She's great in one of my favorite movies, Gremlins 2, as the woman with the microwave. She is hilarious with the gremlins and the set for the infomercial. She's really good. I just don't know why they didn't give her anything other than like weird, creepy jokes with Leslie Nielsen that are, I guess, they kind of land, but.
Yeah, it's like the Farrelly brothers would do that so much better with Lin Shaye in Dumb and Dumber, Kingpin.
I also like to point out Leslie Nielsen and Kathleen Freeman are 3 years apart.
Mm-hmm. I was going to say, I think she's probably older than that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, she was born in 23 and Leslie Nielsen was born in 26.
And Priscilla was 45.
The optics of like the ages in this movie are, 49.
49. Holy shit.
Looking good for 49. I mean, Priscilla Presley looks great, but she's just, again, given nothing to do. She is just there to be. I don't even know what she's there for at this point, frankly. In the first movie, it made sense. In the second movie, it made sense. In this movie, she really feels just forced into the plot of the movie.
I mean, the stuff in the sperm bank goes on for way too long. And apparently there was even more of that stuff. There was like another go at it that is on the TV version. And it's like, oh my gosh, I was done with that after the first time, and especially after the second time, and then we just keep going back. I mean, it was nice to see Julie Strange show up in that dominatrix outfit, but that was about it for me.
Where do you take that gag? Isn't that the woman in a dominatrix outfit the logical final step for that gag?
Right.
Why did they need anything else? I don't know. I mean, they've done that before with this franchise where they take the jokes to their silliest conclusion. This one, just they didn't work whenever they did it.
Well, I like it when they show restraint. If you look at Airplane and Police Squad, the series, they rarely did that thing of escalation. In this one, it seems odd, even with the previous movies and definitely with the show or with Airplane, the things that we've talked about on the show, that escalation doesn't. That is more when this stuff starts to happen in the mid-90s with other comedies where you go as far as you can until it's not funny anymore, and then you go another step further. And I think I talked about that, like that's the Austin Powers setup.
So apparently what was supposed to happen was that he is shown, after the Julie Strain bit, he's shown being wheeled out by a male nurse who asks him to fill out some forms, apparently. And then while he's writing down his name, he sees Tanya receive a phone call and tries to get near her to listen in. Then when the male nurse returns, Drebin hides on a gurney, and a different nurse inadvertently wheels him into a gurney. Wheels the gurney into the OR, which says penile implants on it. Ba-da-ba-ba-da-bop. And then what might have been happening with the Norberg, and this is me giving a lot of credit, the Norberg and Frank thing that you're talking about, was that apparently there's an extra scene in there where Drebin and Norberg talk about a TV soap opera because now Frank is domesticated, so he's all about the soaps and stuff. So I wonder if Norberg was looking at the soap opera.
Maybe. Yeah, maybe.
A hell of a stretch.
It would explain because it's odd. It's really weird.
The one thing I just read about, too, was that there's more of them trying to get away and the way that they pop up in different places. So they pop up on a football field and right. One of them has the ball on their head for like the kick. That would have been good. I mean, the way that it just goes like escape, funeral, South Central L.A., again, super dangerous place, them showing up there and then getting chased away. I mean, it's like what I always talk about, the rule of threes, and we just don't have that.
That gag was done better a year earlier in a movie that's much funnier than this one, which is also a parody movie that has its shit together, which is National Lampoon's Loaded Weapon 1. They do that sewer gag one time in the movie at the final, you know, third act, and it is one of the funniest gags in the entire movie. Mike, you know what I'm talking about, where they come up out of the sewer, similar to this, and it's Emilio Estevez, and he just comes up onto, I guess, in the background is the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles movie.
Right.
Fucking hilarious. And that's it. And then he goes down into the sewer. You don't need to do it 8 times. You just need to do it. If it's funny, you only need to do it once. If it's really funny, you don't need to do him jerking off 4 times. As much as I think that's funny, I actually think the funniest part of that scene is the lead up to it, where they're talking about throwing around the pigskin in the backyard and my uncle was helping me. Like, see, that's where the movie actually sings for a moment, because it's back to the dialogue stuff.
Exactly. That
the movie just completely just forgot about.
That is pretty damn funny. The misunderstanding thing that we've had before and things, and I wish they would have more of it.
You don't get anything like "what's that" or the back and forth with names. There's no Detroit from Cincinnati and all that good stuff. None of that.
I mean, and Pat Proft was credited as a writer on this, and he was good for those. Well, what makes a man is this and this and this, or like the thing at the end of the last movie where it's like, well, I want to be free to be do this and to do this and to, what was it, eat an otter or whatever. And it's just like, you always have those, like the rules of three and getting that last one. The last one is the most outrageous. And it's like, yeah, there's none of that here. They kind of just brush past some of these jokes that they could have had.
In a lot of ways, Leslie Nielsen, Frank Drebin, feels like a non-character in the movie. He doesn't feel like as well-defined a character as he did in the first one and the second one, because most of his definition came through his interactions with other people as a, at times, straight man and at times, bumbling idiot. There's just none of it here. It really does just boil down to a whole lot of visual gags, like just replete with visual gags, which, again, if that's what you're into, you're going to be in for a good time. There are plenty of visual gags.
Oh, yeah.
Leslie Nielsen is a funny actor when he is given the opportunity to just play it straight. They don't even want to do that in this movie, which means they've lost sight of what made this Police Squad / Naked Gun to begin with.
That's my theory. I think part of that is him, though. I don't think he wanted to be the straight man. Watching those trailers just reinforced that to me. Like, this is what he thought was funny, and he wanted to be a comedic actor. He is funniest, to me at least, in Airplane and those first few episodes of Police Squad, where his delivery is 100% straight and deadpan. Those are the things that make me laugh. This, picking up a quarter in the middle of a gunfight on the steps of the bus depot and going, "Oh, I found a quarter." You know, that isn't funny to me. It really isn't.
What about him detaching shopping carts from one another with a blowtorch?
Absolutely unfunny.
But I did appreciate when he grabbed the breasts of the woman from the first movie in a nice callback.
Yeah, there we go. There's a good callback.
Yeah.
Melon lady.
He didn't assault her with a concrete dildo, so opportunity right. Really missed.
He had a giant cucumber in his cart, too. So.
Well, that was probably for Priscilla Presley.
Yeah.
Given the lingerie that she apparently has for their nights together, that's, I mean, a pretty good visual, her with the...
That's hilarious.
Yeah, there are some good visuals, but it feels...
Target in the back.
Yeah.
Well, then they kind of repeat the gag with Leslie Nielsen in prison with his metal
chastity belt thing.
Low-hanging fruit joke, but, you know, kind of works, I think.
Yeah, it feels like
game
they could really...
Yeah, bro.
They really could have done a lot more when it came to just building up that scene with Randall Tex Cobb. All the men running out and all that, like, it could have just built up even more.
Well, shouldn't we be led to believe that if it's not consensual, that's a problem, obviously. But mm-hmm. I don't think Frank Drebin is any kind of a mysterious stranger to gay sex, the way he talked about it in that series.
Oh, yeah. living with that other guy, and pretty soon the neighbors start to talk. And
I'm just pointing out what Frank Drebin is saying. I'm just we're just unpacking what he has to say.
It's definitely in his history.
Yeah.
If the show is canon, which it very well should be.
Just so many of those things. Just so many of the police procedural things. You know, I was checking out this case when I heard about this on the radio. My boss, of course, was there already.
You know,
like, none of that thing. You know, I don't even know. Do we get a voiceover in this movie?
It's there.
He's in his car at one point. No trash cans. Doesn't.
No, it's a parking meter.
And it shoots the quarters everywhere.
Right.
Which is a gag that was like stripped directly out of Fletch Lives, which came out 4 years earlier, to the point that in that movie, Fletch, he does the thing that Leslie Nielsen should have done, which is Fletch picks the thing up, takes one of the quarters and sticks it in and then drops it back on the ground. I mean, that's funny. Him just hitting it and then going brr and walking off and looking at the camera and going brr ain't funny. I think you're right, Mark. Leslie Nielsen playing the straight man is not funny for him. So why would he want to do it, right?
Right.
He's so good at it, though.
I know. It's
no one sat him down and said, do you realize how many people love and laughed at your Don't Call Me Shirley line?
Oh, yeah.
Let's watch that again, Leslie. And look, let's look at this.
I would watch a show of Mark talking to actors about their movies.
Did you know? This is what people love you for.
Right.
I've got to wonder, did he not know that? Like, that line is funny because it's fucking straight as an arrow.
Yeah, I know.
I just want you to know that we're all really counting on you.
Right.
Some of his best lines. It's a really big building with a lot of patients inside, but that's not important right now.
His best lines, as far as I'm concerned. That and those first couple of episodes of the show where he is still playing it completely straight are the funniest things for me.
Even that first movie, he plays it pretty straight. That first movie is a little bit of a return to form for the show.
Well, even think of just that joke of, is this some kind of a bust? Yes, ma'am. Very impressive.
Right.
Totally straight. Not like, you know.
Exactly.
Well, one of the best gags in the first movie is everywhere I look reminds me of her. And there's no reaction shot of people going to the breasts, the giant cone, but whatever the hell those are. There's nobody mugging to that. I don't know where they thought the mugging was funnier, I guess is my question. Like, what did they see or what were they reading or what information were they getting back from people that would lead them to believe the mugging was funnier? Because, again, we know they can. It's not like we don't know they can write good comedy. We know they can. It's that they've deviated away from it. So I don't know what would cause them to deviate away from it, because they know it was successful and they know that people thought it was funny because that's what they cut their teeth on for a decade.
And they're still testing this stuff like crazy. They're still going out and showing it to audiences and just like taking a straight razor and cutting things out. It's a lot of stuff they cut out sounds like it'd be hilarious. Like the when he goes into prison, there's supposed to be like a lion in one of the cages. There's supposed to be a mime holding on to fake bars, you know, like I can see the mime with like a cup, you know, like going across. That would have been hilarious. And that's just not there. Like when they do the visit to Rocco in prison and it's all of the people like the hockey goalie and the
bank teller.
Yeah, exactly. And just the aquarium, all of these things, like all of those jokes, it's just like boom, 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 boom. We're not pointing to these things. They're just happening on screen. And then we get to Rocco and that's it. It feels like the Rocco scene, like there should have been more to it. Like I like when his mother is talking about Anna Nicole Smith and he's just like, oh, mom giving me boy cramps. But otherwise, it's like there's not a whole lot to that scene. And like Pap Schmier, why would you hire a guy who's in jail rather than a guy who's already walking around out free?
Why is Pap Schmier in this movie to begin
with? Right. That's what I was asking myself today. Why him?
Well, and he's talking about terrorism. It's like he's still in the pocket of all those terrorists from the first movie. And it's like, guys, nobody remembers Pap Schmier. I'm sorry. He just was not that memorable. Had I not watched these pretty much three in a row, I would not have remembered that that guy was in the first film.
He was not a character in the first movie, and he's really not a character in this movie. I guess he gets less screen time in this movie than he does in the first one. because he has that whole back end. Well, no, it's probably about the same. I guess he dies in this one, so at least there's that. Like, he was such a memorable villain, who cares?
Well, at least it's better than having Saddam Hussein, even though we get the Bill Clinton impersonator, the Pope John Paul II impersonator, and then we get a really good terrorist joke as well. And you even have to throw in some ADR to say disgruntled postal workers.
Can I point out that Gene Graytak is one of my favorite actors I'd never heard of until looking into him? Guy was in nothing but movies playing the Pope, and he was a real estate broker. And he had the permission to perform as the Pope and impersonate him from the Archdiocese of Los Angeles. So,
wow,
he looks like John Paul II in a way that, again, I've seen this movie plenty of times, but I always forget when you can find an impersonator who doesn't have to talk, but just looks like him, like the Queen of England in the first movie. It does work. He has the nose, man. Just,
oh yeah,
perfect.
It's a lot better than hearing that George Bush impersonator from the second one.
Or even this Bill Clinton.
Yeah.
Yeah.
This movie had how much money in a budget, and that was the Bill Clinton impersonator they hired? Jeez.
$30 million.
That was one of the worst that I've seen.
I was really excited to learn that there was a fourth movie that was supposed to come out in 2000s, like the late 2000s, early 10s. There was a script kicking around called Naked Gun, What For?, which is a pretty good title.
Mm.
That is.
Apparently, it was going to parody movies like Infernal Affairs and The Departed, like corrupt cop movies, and have Leslie Nielsen be the Obi-Wan, as it was put. I have not read the script, but I have read people talking about the script.
Wow.
And he was going to hand off Police Squad to a new generation. So kind of what they talked about with a lot of the franchises from the 80s and 90s in the 2000s, what they tried to do, they were going to try to do that here. They wanted to reduce Leslie Nielsen's part in the movie, and then they completely took it out. And then the guy who wrote the script said, I'm not doing this anymore. That's a shame, I guess. I mean, 2009 would have been Scary Movie 3, Scary Movie 4, Leslie Nielsen. He could have thrown the jacket back on as Frank Drebin one more time, I feel. He was in all those other movies he made.
Yeah. I was just going to say, he's thrown it on plenty of times.
Yeah, speak about a transition into things people shouldn't be talking about. Well, I don't know if anybody's doing an episode of a podcast on Wrongfully Accused in 2023 or 2001, A Space Travesty.
Oh, boy.
Yeah. Well, I mean, when you make your bread and butter doing one thing, people are going to want you to do it for them to diminishing returns.
What was the one with Weird Al? The Disney?
Oh, Safety Patrol. That was the weird one that we stumbled across. It is a Disney Channel movie with Bug Hall, the kid who plays Alfalfa in the Little Rascals movie, who is a like Safety Patrol kid at his school. And Leslie Nielsen is in the movie. And so is Weird Al. And Weird Al makes a song in the movie about how terrible a literal 10-year-old is. And sings it in front of a group of children and is like, you're a piece of shit, essentially, like just calling him like a terrible.
Humiliates him.
And in front of a group of kids while the good kids are cheering him on. So it's very weird. We went down a very deep, dark rabbit hole with this movie into the Leslie Nielsen assorted media of years post Naked Gun 33 and a third.
Wow.
Ending with the Mr. Magoo trailer, which I feel is what he liked to do. Being the bumbling idiot with the constant mugging.
I honestly don't remember disliking that Mr. Magoo movie. That was a movie I saw it a lot as a kid. I mean, it was a Disney movie from the 90s. So I probably just equated it to this movie. I probably remember things from it thinking that it's Leslie Nielsen playing Frank Drebin in this movie. Because again, it's a lot of physical comedy. A lot of the stuff that we didn't like with this movie, like Mark said in the trailer for that movie, you can see it's a lot of physical slapstick, which that's guess what Leslie Nielsen really wanted to do. That was what he really yearned to do. And I'm glad that people let him do it. But
hey, more power to him then.
Yeah, it wasn't the funniest stuff that he could provide. That's the shame, really, because he was a funny straight man. But I get why you wouldn't want to be the straight man if you think you're funny, because the straight man is a thankless job. Like, you're the dude who helps make everybody else laugh, but you're not the one making people laugh.
And back to the mugging, this was mentioned earlier as to why it veered in that direction. And I think it's just not trusting an audience to get a joke without a visual cue of either him making a face at the camera or the other characters making a face at each other. That happens a lot in the films. Doesn't happen on the show. Doesn't happen in Airplane, where he'll say an idiotic thing, and then the two other people in the scene will look at each other. Fred Warden and Anna Nicole Smith do that a couple of times. And I think it's a cue to the audience that that was a funny line.
Well, it's like an applause button, right?
Right.
That's not funny. Like, it actively makes things unfunny.
If the audience isn't getting it, I don't see how the visual cue from someone in the movie all of a sudden makes it funny.
Also, if the audience isn't getting it, was it actually funny to begin with?
Sorry, my mind just flashed to the Where's Waldo reference.
Do you have like a Naked Gun 33 and a third flashback?
Yeah.
Oh, I just had another one, guys.
He's still relevant, right?
Yeah.
He's still relevant.
Do people still look at those books?
Where's Waldo? I don't know. Don't kids have phones now? They don't need to look at fucking...
Well, I mean, I'm still looking for them.
Yeah, Mike is still fighting the good fight for the rest of us.
He's in the audience of the Oscars, 1994 Ooh. Oscars. So there you go. You don't need to look anymore. I don't think we should have Phil Donahue back next year.
That whole thing was one of my favorite lines. The fact that Leslie Nielsen does look like Phil Donahue with glasses on is funny. That is not a wasted gag. It's almost done into the ground, but it's not wasted. That's for sure.
I guess it's smart that they don't show the real Phil Donahue at any point to
remind you.
Yeah,
exactly what he looks like.
The smartest way to do it would have been having Phil Donahue watching him doing it, been like, what the fuck?
You're getting super angry about this.
Yeah. Run a chair.
Yeah.
Right.
Oh, that was Geraldo's show.
Man, we've come a long way in these last 10 weeks, gentlemen.
Yeah.
All the way from Airplane to here.
Yeah.
Yes. I think
the trajectory looks something like this.
Just a steep crash into the ground.
It's pretty, unfortunately, I do think it is a downward trajectory, at least for me personally. I have enjoyed everything just a little bit less as we've gone on. But I think that'll pick back up when we take a right turn into Top Secret land. I am very much looking forward to that.
I hope so. And I'm sure, Mark, you've seen it before. Chris, have you seen this one? Have you seen Top Secret?
No.
Well, I'm very curious to get your impression of it.
I'm excited to watch it because it's something, again, I've never seen it. I did want to mention, as we kind of start heading towards the end of the Police Squad experience, something worth watching past this show that not only scratches the itch of this show, at least the show part of this, not the movies so much, but the constant gags and funny dialogue-heavy gags. The show from Sky One, A Touch of Cloth, which is a euphemism for pooping, by the way. To shit oneself is
crowning, as I like to call it around here.
Today I learned touching cloth means to shit oneself. It stars John Hannah, who plays the brother in The Mummy, in the new Mummy films, not the Tom Cruise one. And he plays a Leslie Nielsen, Frank Drebin type cop in the first two seasons. And in the third season, it kind of goes more into like Bosch, more, I don't know, like contemporary cop shows. It's still a contemporary show, but the first season is 2 episodes, 40 minutes each. Second season is 2 episodes, 40 minutes. Third is the same. The first two seasons are what I wanted from this show and then some.
Hmm.
And it is totally worth checking out. It's a little hard to track down. It only got 3 seasons, but each season's only 2 episodes. You could watch it in an afternoon, but it really captures the feeling of this show and takes it in some interesting kind of fun directions that this show probably would have gone in if given the opportunity. Like, one of the best gags in the show that just kind of reminds me of this show and this franchise. At one point, you have a character with its back to the screen, another character talking, and the character with their back to the screen is talking but saying, and we left this scene in, so in case we had to come back and fix something that you guys, that we forgot to mention in the script, that's why this is here, so that's why you can't see me.
Wow. Kind of Garth Marenghi.
More or less. I mean, it has that British sensibility to it that this show...
Which I love.
Right. I would say it's almost like the British version of Police Squad, but some of the jokes, if you do watch it, you're going to go, oh, right, that was in Police Squad. So it is British Police Squad, but at the same time, like, it really is just kind of that next step in the right direction. Third season, it's okay, but the first two seasons are amazing. And John Hannah, I had not seen him in anything other than The Mummy, but he is really good. He's as good as Leslie Nielsen is, frankly, which is saying a lot.
The gal that co-stars with him and is in just a million things that my wife and I watch on BritBox or PBS. She's in a gazillion British police procedurals. She's always playing the tough DC or DCI. And
right.
When you pass that along, I looked at it and I'm like, is that the same gal? Oh my God. It'll be interesting to see her in a comedic role because everything else has been deadly serious with major
ramifications. Well, she's also in Gentleman Jack, which is on HBO Max, which is pretty good as well. But you guys should check it out. And if you're listening to this and you are a fan of Police Squad, which that's why you're here, you should totally check it out as well. It is worth tracking down however you go about tracking it down. It is so much in the vein of this that it would be a shame to not mention it because I have never heard anybody else talk about it. I've never heard anybody else mention it. The only reason I found it is because we are doing this show and it's at the bottom of the Wikipedia with some other entries. One of them is a show that I think we may have mentioned last time that I wasn't as good, Angie Tribeca, which you guys kind of said wasn't great. And then the other one, Sledgehammer, the guy who wrote Sledgehammer is the guy who wrote the script for that fourth Naked Gun movie that never came out.
That makes sense.
So they're all kind of connected. But for me, like, I love Police Squad, but this show, it takes it and just does something interesting with it. So definitely check it out. Here, I'm going to step off my soapbox.
Well, I'm going to watch it on your...
You can edit this out.
I think I'll watch it on Chris's too.
Yeah.
I'm going to generate a tone for that on there for you.
I'm going to watch it. Beep. Well, I don't know where else you would watch it. So that would be where you could find it or on YouTube probably. So the thing is with these kinds of shows, like we've already talked about, they're so hard to do well that when you find one that's done well, you just want to tell everybody else who likes them, because if you have not heard them talk about it, they may not know about it either. I felt the same way when I first saw Mafia for the first time. Like, I had never seen it and I saw it and I was like, this is amazing. So I kind of felt the same way with this. I was laughing out loud watching the first two seasons of this show. More excited to watch Top Secret, frankly, because that's the people who are making this being funny, making Police Squad.
Even though they don't like it because it didn't make very much money.
It's been a long time since I watched it, but I remember liking it a lot. Yeah, I'm excited too. I've been meaning to watch it actually for the last couple of years and just had never. I'm now at this point really burned out on comedies. I don't watch this much comedy. Usually,
I don't like to laugh.
Yeah,
I
don't. Mark Begley lost his smile, ladies and gentlemen. He's been looking for it ever since he had to watch Naked Gun 33 and a third.
I will tell you guys, Airplane, I own that one on DVD and I have for years, and it's one that I will go back to. Top Secret, same. Definitely, it's a rewatchability thing for me. You know, I watched the original Police Squad when it was on TV. And then I watched it again a few years ago, just did a rewatch off of the DVDs. But Naked Gun, it's like, I think I've seen each of these movies, other than maybe on cable. I think I've seen them all just once theatrically, and that was it. I feel a little validated, like, okay, yeah, like there's some good bits in here, but it's really just, I'm okay sticking with the three things that I just mentioned. And every once in a while, too, I'll do a Kentucky Fried Movie. But with Kentucky Fried Movie, it's like there's a couple of the skits that I like, but for the most part, it's that Fistful of Chopsticks part that I just, or sorry, Fistful of Yen that I just absolutely love. And that is kind of like the last 30 minutes of this movie and the last 30 minutes of the first movie. It's kind of self-contained and you don't really need to watch a whole lot more than that.
They should have taken the third act of the first movie, the third act, the second movie, the third act, the third movie, strung those together, and you got an hour and a half movie. We don't need anything else.
Right.
There you go. Why didn't they ever just put Leslie Nielsen in a skyscraper like fucking Bruce Willis? How was that something that how did nobody do that? How was that not the logical direction to go with one of these movies? The biggest action movies at the time is what this should have been parodying, if that's where this is going. And they didn't parody Die Hard. He's a cop, for fuck's sake.
So this movie was 82 minutes with 6 minutes of end credits and at least a minute of the opening with the car going through everywhere. I did appreciate the pinball machine gag in this one.
It's the best one in all of them.
So it's technically about 76 minutes of movie, and it doesn't feel that short. So there's that.
It's overstayed its welcome.
If for some wild reason my daughter's like, hey, let's watch one of the Naked Gun movies, I'll be like, okay, sure, let's try the first one again, maybe.
I mean, there's still a couple lines. Hey, it's Enrico Palazzo. Like some of those things, that's great. Not nearly the quotability.
Yeah, there's always a handful of jokes that land really well, but this one, they're few and far between, and there's too much plot going on.
All right, how are we going to wrap this whole show up, guys?
Well, I guess there's only one way to wrap this up. The next time you hear us, we're going to be talking about Naked Gun. The reboot, folks. Who knows when? I mean, who knows?
Right. We'll come back to that.
At some point in the near future, we'll post an episode of the three of us talking about a movie that feels like a joke right now.
Yeah.
Ooh, are we going to do a trailer reaction video?
Yeah.
Only if we can post on the thumbnail you going, bah!
Okay. You got it. You got a deal.
Okay, cool. Mike White's reaction to the Naked Gun trailer.
Mind blown.
I can't believe they brought the cigarette gag back.
Rip you, jump out the window.
On fire like that guy in Alan North's opening. Yeah.
Look, all I want is one thing from the reboot or sequel. Leslie Nielsen or Liam Neeson to be Leslie Nielsen and Priscilla Presley's child. That's all I want. Nothing else.
That
would
be great.
This is just the stupidest thing possible would be for him to be Leslie Nielsen's child.
Well, he did try to adopt that 17-year-old Korean girl.
Yes.
Subtle.
Subtle Woody Allen jab.
Oh, boy.
The most subtle of digs, frankly.
Oh, man. And that one lands. One of the few. And there's a couple references in this, and I think they're baseball references that I'm just like, I don't get this one at all. Like, towards the end, there's one line where he says something and drops a name, and I'm just like, I don't know what you're talking about.
And I don't know how many people honestly remember the Woody Allen bit.
Oh, well, yeah, I'm of that age.
Yeah, I mean, I am too. We caught it when we watched it, but I'm just wondering, since there's no actual mention of him, if that'll just be like,
well, what's that?
It'll just seem like a weird sex thing.
It does seem like a weird sex thing without the context.
It works on that level as well.
Is it a weird? No, I guess it is a Woody Allen reference, right?
It's got to be. Yeah.
Hey, you know what? At least you can still go and watch ads for Dutch telephones with Leslie Nielsen shilling Dutch telephones. And then also selling, what is it? What was it, Mark? Red Rock Cider playing Frank Drebin?
Basically, yes.
The Fraud Squad. They even had, like, there were visual gags. There were dialogue gags. Those are the real sequels to the Naked Gun or Police Squad show. Are these, like, it's like 6 minutes long on YouTube. It's like the Red Rock Cider Fraud Squad with Leslie Nielsen and a guy who kind of looks like the dude from Police Squad. Like, he's always being followed around by like some lackey who talks to him too, kind of like Al did, or I guess Nordberg did in the show. So Al Hawken in the show. So yeah, he was just doing this, man, forever. Like, good on him, I guess.
And there's a couple of gags in a few of those ads that are better than any of the gags in the movies, to be honest with you.
Yeah, like straight up. Some of them are pretty, like, actually laugh out loud funny. So, again, just worth mentioning all these other weird Naked Gun pieces of ephemera that, like, exist. Because I guess Naked Gun has been a popular enough franchise for all these weird things to exist. Like a Naked Gun point-and-click computer game that came out in 2012 featuring Frank Drebin Jr.
Liam Neeson?
Well, hopefully. I don't know where all the love comes from, because it's not like I hear people my age talking about Naked Gun. All right. Hey.
Yeah. I mean, it was around for, what, 14? No.
12 years.
Mm-hmm. 12 years. Yeah, pretty good chunk. And to have three movies come out pretty close to succession definitely took a lot less time to make these than it did to make a Star Wars film.
Not much less, though.
All the de-aging that they had to do on Leslie Nielsen really took up time and effort. And hey, we didn't even mention the ending of the movie. The most bizarre way to end this series of films. With a Nordberg fucked your wife gag.
Like, what? Yeah.
What?
I guess I missed it.
Yeah.
What? You missed that?
At the end of the movie, Frank and Nordberg are in the delivery room, clearly.
Oh, yeah.
And it's a black baby.
Right.
It's not hers. They're in the wrong room. Right. So I guess I didn't like, catch that. I'm a little slow.
I'm not a smart man, but I know what love is.
That's why he's like, Nordberg?
Yeah, but that's the way they end this series. Like, all right.
All right. No freeze frame.
Nope.
No.
What a missed opportunity.
In any of the films.
Especially like if like OJ was running down the hall and had to stop and then was like freezing like that and then would start to fall over.
Yeah.
I could write these movies better than these guys.
Like a joke, like a funny thing, like something we might laugh at like that. Like one of those, huh? Yeah. And that's the sad thing about watching movies critically, especially comedies, is if it doesn't work for you, there's not a lot else to really watch in a movie, especially a comedy. A lot of the times if what you are watching isn't funny, there's not going to be much else for you to spend your time watching. I'm with you, Mark. I don't watch a lot of comedies primarily because I don't like to watch ones I've never seen for fear of them being terrible and me just having to suffer through them for an hour and a half, 2 hours. I tend to stay away from them.
I do too.
There are very few comedies that I can even recommend that have come out over the last 10 years.
Same. Which is why I'm so worried about a Naked Gun sequel being written by one of the people is Seth MacFarlane, who was so funny when he wrote for Liam Neeson last time in 1,000 Ways to Die in the West. So,
oh my God.
Like, why are we torturing ourselves here, folks? Like, we're doing this to ourselves. This is self-inflicted at this point.
And I think part of it is we don't have a lot of, it's not like comedies are constantly coming out either. Like, I like Step Brothers. I think one of the more recent comedies that we've all enjoyed as a family is, what the heck is it called? The Good Boys? Is it The Good Boys?
Yeah.
With the little Jacob Tremblay.
Jacob Tremblay movie? Yeah.
I get a kick out of that. We've watched it a couple times. But yeah, a lot of times I think I have a very particular taste in what I find funny, and most films don't deliver that. And that's not the film's fault. That's me. That's like I have come to realize I have a very peculiar and particular idea of what's funny. Murder by Death, I find funny. Young Frankenstein, I find funny. Airplane, I find funny. Naked Gun, not as much.
I enjoyed Date Night quite a bit, but I think a lot of that was Jesse Plemons just being amazing.
Oh, yeah. Game Night?
Game Night, thank you. Yeah, Date Night was a totally different movie.
Game Night is very good.
Date Night, the one with Steve Carell? I was like, what movie is Date Night? What movie is Game Night? I don't even know which movies you're talking about.
That brings in Jason Bateman and then all those films like Office, Christmas Party, or whatever.
Horrible Bosses.
So those things, it's like, I watch them and I'm like, they toe that line. Not as bad as the Paul Feig riffathons, but I feel like still a lot of that is going on. Like, let's just keep saying stuff until we find something funny, and then that's what we'll use. But Game Night is very good. Yes.
Yeah, I thought that was solid. I want to say I remember liking Cock Blockers a little bit as well, or I think they might have just called it Blockers with John Cena.
Oh yeah, I remember that movie.
I wanted to watch that one.
And then him, like, for you can take the rest of the movie and just shove it up your ass, but the one with Amy Schumer, is it?
Yeah.
With John Cena? John
with Bill Cena's Hader?
Role. Oh, my God. Cena in that movie is fucking fantastic.
I will find you on Grindr.
So good.
Yeah, no, John Cena's fucking hilarious. Like, I think that's the problem now with modern comedy is spoofs and stuff are fine, but they're so sparse and so infrequent that all we get are stuff like what we're talking about, this like character based comedy, Judd Apatow stuff. It in and of itself all feels very samey because of stuff, because of how successful 40 Year Old Virgin was. I'm with you, Mark. Like, I have a hard time with comedy because this was one lane of comedy that was dominant for so long. And then in the mid 2000s, another lane of comedy took over. And now we're in the, I would say we're in like the Dan Harmon comedy world now, where it's like subversive, weird shit all the time, like Rick and Morty and High on Life and whatever the hell the other shows that he and Justin Roiland do that are all just Rick and Morty over and over and over again. No offense to you fans of Rick and Morty, but one show is fine. Eight shows, I don't need it over and over again. But like all of those lanes now exist at the same time. They're not making the kinds of movies that I like anymore. So I'm more interested in watching the stuff that I've already seen or watching older stuff that I've never seen. Cause I don't, the spoofs that they're making now, they don't interest me the way that the old ones do. Like Holmes and Watson is a spoof. Okay. Like that movie's a fucking nightmare, like a genuine cinematic nightmare. So they're just not doing what I want with comedy. And so I think similar to yourself, Mark, I just not searching them out anymore. Like as much as we have kind of ragged on Naked Gun 1, 2, and 3, movies are more in my wheelhouse than most stuff coming out, at least from what I want from a comedy movie or what I'm expecting from a comedy or what my intention to laugh is, at least.
I will tell you that of all the spoof movies that have come out over the last however many years, like we've talked a little bit about some of the scary movies, but what was that one? Was it Not Another Teen Movie?
Yeah.
The one with like Chris Evans and that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Very early Chris Evans.
I found a lot of that to be hilarious. I don't understand all the jokes about people shitting on each other, like literally shitting on each other. But some of that other stuff, like especially the parody of the detention scene from Breakfast Club, that I watch very often.
Think of something else from the 90s similar to that. Like Basketball is a fucking great parody movie.
It's a great movie.
Like yes. It's a spoof. And it's directed by looky looky who fucking directed it. David Zucker, for fuck's sake. Like it's not like they can't make good movies. It's clear, I think, to the three of us that the Zuckers, at least the Zuckers, maybe not Jim Abrahams or Abrams, they are very emotionally driven people. If they don't like Top Secret because it didn't make them money, that's putting a horse before a cart in a very obvious and apparent way. I think Naked Gun was clearly a means to an end. And at some point it just became a money factory, right? We'll pump out a script and then they'll pump us full of money. And they've made how much money? They made like double to triple the budget on each of these movies. You know, Basketball didn't make like any money. So, and I would put it above all of the Naked Gun movies, period. I think that's a funnier movie overall, directed by David Zucker, made no money. Nothing came of it afterwards. They can make good things. I just think Naked Gun made them so much money that, like, why else did Judd Apatow keep making 40-Year-Old Virgin style movies? Because they made tons of money. It's complacency and it's being lazy. At least we have Police Squad, the first three episodes of the show. At least we still have that.
Well, Chris, until we come back and talk again about the Liam Neeson version of Naked Gun, where can people find my work, your work, Mark's work, everybody who's doing good work out there?
WeirdingWayMedia.com is your place to go for this show. And like Mike mentioned, Mark Begley's Wake Up Heavy, Mike White's The Projection Booth, and, well, The Culture Cast for me. All of our shows, plus many more, can be found over at WeirdingWayMedia.com. And if you can't find it over there, well, just let us know if you want to hear it. Maybe we'll put a show on the network that you would like. I don't know. Try to be nice and civil to people.
Why not?
That works.
Just make suggestions and we'll create it.
If anything, a suggestion box will be funny to laugh at. Well, that's
all right.
Leave that fucking clip in there at the end.
Yeah.